All right, here we go. Hello, hello. Welcome to the 10 a.m. Friday streaming project thing. Hi, I'm Nick, and today we're going to be working on texturing in Blender. Now, what is that? So, in a lot of the previous videos, I went through how to model something. If you haven't seen that set of videos, we went through and modeled a very simple spaceship, maybe more of a hovercraft kind of thing. It definitely did not look like it was ready for space, but nevertheless, spaceship. So if you want to check out that series of tutorials, I'll put some links in the doobly-doo thingamabobber thing below in the description, and you can check those out. We're still finishing up. There should be, I think, one more lesson coming out next week just to wrap that all up at some point. But once you have something modeled in 3D, the basic idea is that you want to make it actually look like something. You don't want it to just be this kind of gray shape, gray clay blob. You want to make it actually appear like it is a thing. And part of that is texturing. Texturing is going to control, for example, I've got my water bottle right here. Obviously, as we move this around the light, and you see that has a very particular sheen. It's reflecting light a very specific way. And all materials are going to reflect light very differently. You can even see from this material to this one that this is much more reflective versus this, which is scattering the light a little bit more. And there's going to be different bumps and textures which are going to scatter the light. Some are made out of different materials, which will change the sheen. And that's all what texturing is about. And it's a very important part of when you are making something in 3D, whether that's for like a Pixar movie or a video game, or even if it's stylized versus realistic, it all comes down to that. And it also comes down to lighting as well. We're not gonna do a lot of lighting today. We are gonna use some lights because you can't do any texturing without lights. So we are gonna do some lights, but we're mostly gonna be focusing on this. And today's gonna be interesting because I actually haven't textured anything in Blender since its previous major release. So I think the last version I textured something was in 1.75, and then I started focusing on modeling a little bit, and I know there have been significant changes. So this is going to be an interesting journey this morning. So we're gonna jump in and try some things out together and see what happens. Mistakes will probably be made, but you know what? That's part of the learning process, and that's okay. So let's go ahead and switch over to my desktop view here. Now, I already went ahead and downloaded a model. This is a origami panther, which I got from Thingiverse. So this is from WLAN Cabell. Sorry. But it's from this particular artist. So you can go on to Thingiverse. I will include this link in the description. You can go ahead and just click download all files. That way we're working with the same exact item. Again, before we start, always with good folder organization, we're going to go into our Blender tutorials. And this one is going to be intro to texturing. We're going to go into here and we're going to pop this folder right in there. And now we're going to extract this. So I'm going to right click on it. We're going to go to extract all. And now we've got a folder here. So basically, if you haven't used Thingiverse before, essentially what it is, it's a site where you can download models for free. Some users just ask you to credit them. Others will say you can print this, but you can't use it for commercial stuff. Everyone's gonna have a different version. So I believe the license here is under, CC stands for Creative Commons, which means that you can, there's different varying levels, but basically we're good because we're using this for educational purposes. We're not selling it. We're not doing X, Y, and Z. There are some instances where the Creative Commons license allows you to remix it and then sell it, but definitely double check. In fact, I'm gonna put a quick thing up here. Creative Commons. Creative Cinema names? All right, that's weird. Creative Commons license. And if we go to about the licenses, this is creativecommons.org. So this will go into what the actual licenses do, the layers of the licenses. So I definitely encourage you to read this. Bear in mind that just because you're not making money off of something, that does not necessarily mean you're free from copyright. I'm not a lawyer, so it's not that I'm not authorized to talk about, but it is definitely, I have a basic understanding of how this stuff works, but I am not an authority by any sense of the means to make any legal decisions for you. But if you're just using it for learning or for like a personal home project, you're good. So now we've got that technical jib jab out of the way. You can see that we've got some files and images here. We're going to be focusing on the files. So you can see that we've got two STL files. STL stands for stereolithography. It's a particular way of saving out files, typically used for, in most purposes, for at least us, in 3D printing. So we're going to be using this guy most of all. But now we've got that out. What I might do just to keep this a little bit more organized is I may create a new folder. Let's call this Thingiverse files. Because if I need to download more stuff, I want them to all go in here. So we'll pop that in there. Great. Now we're going to create another folder for Blender files. I'm gonna lower the music just a tad, but I'm really digging it. Okay, that's a much better level. Cool. We're going to go to Blender. And make sure you have the most recent version of Blender, which... Actually, I think I'm actually behind. Let's actually take a quick look here. 2.82a. Ooh, okay. So I am a little behind, but I should be fine for this tutorial. I will go ahead and update this as soon as we're done. Now, I'm going to go ahead and left-click off on the side here just to get rid of that splash page. Let me just see something real quick. Okay, cool. Now, normally what we do is we delete the camera, the light source, and the cube to start. I'm actually going to keep the camera. We're going to use that. You know what? We could probably keep most of this. Let's actually just experiment with this setup right... let's keep... You know, we're going to go ahead and delete the cube and the light source. So I'm going to hold down shift, select both with left click, hit X, and delete. I'm going to go over to add, mesh, and I'm going to add a ground plane. And basically, we need this to kind of catch the light. So I'm going to scale this up by hitting S and dragging out. I want a fair amount of space here. And from here, we actually need to import the model. And I'm suspecting it's going to be very large compared to this, because when you're working in Blender, their Blender units don't really have an actual correspondence to the real world units. They're just Blender units. Blender units could be a mile, a foot, an inch, a millimeter. So when we import the STL, I'm guessing it's going to be a bit larger. You can set scale in Blender, but generally, if you're not going to export it out into a 3D printer, it doesn't really matter. So we're going to go to import, STL. We're going to go over to desktop, Blender tutorials. Let's go to intro to texturing, Thingiverse files, Panther origami files, and Panther. Yep, super large. That's okay. So we'll select it. We'll hit S for scale, and we'll make this a little bit smaller. Yeah, we can make it a little bit larger. That's fine. Now, one thing we're going to do here is if we click this button over here, we're jumping to camera view. Right now, we have a shot of its feet, which, you know, not exactly a thrilling camera angle. So we're actually going to move this. And the way I like to do this is I like to split up my screen a little bit so that I have a little bit more control over what I'm doing. Now, to do this, it's a little tricky. There used to be a slight icon in the upper right-hand corner that would tell you when you're in the right section. But, so this whole window here is the 3D view. And then you've got the file editor up here. You've got the outliner, which we're going to use a little bit more. Basically, in order for me to resize menus, I need to go up to the upper right corner of the menu, which you can see my mouse is right up here. It's kind of turned into like a little targeting icon. I'm going to left-click, drag to the left while holding it, and now I've dragged out a new window. And what's cool about this is these are independent windows of the 3D view. So on my right side window here, if I start navigating, you can either use the middle mouse button or the gizmo over here. We can now move around, and I can still see what's going on in my camera. In fact, I'm going to, on my left side, just zoom in a little bit, so that's a little larger. I'm going to go to the divider line here, left click and just drag that over. So that way I can still see my camera view, but I have a little bit more space over here. I actually have multiple monitors, but I'm assuming that you are working at home with a single monitor. If you have a second monitor, you could totally take advantage of it, but you can still resize these however you want. You can split these up to down, split them left to right. I would urge you not to go too crazy, however, because the smaller you make these panels, the more difficult it's going to be for you to work in any of them. You can see now that this is now really just all over the place. If you make too many panels, it's really easy. You have to hover back to the upper right-hand corner, and drag them in the opposite direction or the opposite order of how you created them. So this was the last little bit I did. So I'm going to do left click, drag that up. You'll see this change icon to an up arrow, and there's a little gray section that represents that as well. I'll let go, and these have now merged. So I'm going to do the same thing going backwards. Cool. Now what we're going to do is we're going to adjust our camera. We're going to left click on it. We're going to go to our move tool, and let's move this back up. And we can also, let's actually go ahead and split this up to down real quick. Make that a little bit smaller. And basically what we're going to do here is I'm going to change this to top view. So I'm going to click on the Z-axis here. So we're locked in on the top. And oh, that's my phone. You think I would have learned to turn this off by now, but I haven't. We're going to left click and drag this out. So I'm going to basically just get a top view here so I can see what's going on. There we go. And with the camera selected in the top view, I'm actually just going to hit G so I can just drag it back. And I'll left click and move this up a little bit more. I kind of like that angle. I might actually move this over, go to my rotate tool, left click and drag, and maybe do that. You can play around with this for a few minutes. Something like that. Now, if you can see the outer gray area here, you can just select the ground plane, scale this out, and you're good to go. And this is also a really good opportunity for us to name our stuff. Right now, oh, it says Panther. I guess they forgot the H. So we're going to go ahead and rename these. Camera, you can keep as is. The plane here, we're going to change to ground. So I should back up a little bit. This is the outliner. Essentially, it's going to list everything that's in the scene and the connections that you have with it. So, or connections between the objects, I should say. So I just named it outline. No, this is ground. And awesome. Oh, they actually got rid of the shortcut here for the non-click. That's okay. And we're going to rename this to Panther. Camera we can keep. That's great. Generally, for my naming conventions, which we talked about in the tech tip and you should check out, I prefer not using capitalization. I do like to use camel casing because it's just easier to type. And you don't have to worry about spaces and whatnot. So I usually have the first letter be lowercase. That's personal preference. You can do whatever you need to for yours. All right, so we've got this all laid out. We've got the camera in the right spot. Now we need to add some lights. So we're going to use, I think, two or three. We're just going to do a really basic light setup. In fact, we'll probably just get away with two for this. Now, in order to do that, we're going to go over to add. And before, we messed around with just the mesh objects, which are totally fine. But we're going to go over to light. Ooh, what's light probe? I'm going to have to experiment with that later. But we're going to go over to light. We're going to add in a sun lamp. Now, this is pretty cool in that you can go ahead and let's actually go over to our Sorry, I'm going a little fast here. So what I did really quickly is I moved the sun up and back, and then I clicked on it and I went down to this little light bulb down in the properties menu. And properties are going to control the different attributes and values of your object. And in this case, because I have the sun lamp selected, this is going to give me the controls for the sun lamp. We're going to go ahead and rotate the sun lamp so it's pointing at the panther. Maybe we'll have it rotate around. We'll have it come from this angle. And we're actually going to do a render test. It's a good idea to test your rendering as you go. And it looks like we're on the render engine Eevee. So we should be able to change this to Is there a render viewport shading? Ah, so this button on the right-hand side will actually give you a real-time feedback of what things are looking like. So this is to help you kind of just get an idea of what things look like a lot faster. I've seen some really cool videos where the real-time rendering is actually really good looking, and Eevee is the engine that controls that. However, I generally want to do a quick render test as well, because the viewport shader, while really good, I think is not as accurate as your final render. So you can definitely work with Eevee to get everything pretty close to setup, but you should definitely do render test at major milestones. So let me see where they move the button around for that. Render image. So when we do that, because our image is so simple right now, you can see that this is very similar to the viewport, but here you can see that we have an actual rendered image, and this is going to come out as a separate window. We can actually just go ahead and close this. That was just a quick render test. In fact, we can actually split this top to bottom, zoom this in a little bit, and I'm going to change this window over here to, I believe it's the image editor. And I'm going to change this to, so the image editor allows you to work with images, just in case you didn't know. We're going to click this button right up here. We're going to change this to render result. So that way, every time we render image now, it pops out still. All right, I'm sure there's a button that will control that. Let me see if we can find it real quick. I have to see what Workbench is. I know Cycles is the full-on render engine, which I'm betting if we do that and render it again. Sorry, I'm just experimenting real quick. Yeah, now it's going through the full rendering process. Which, because this is so simple, we can probably just get away with Eevee for right now. So really quickly, render engines are how the program calculates a final image. So I don't know how Eevee specifically works. I think it's processed specifically for processed for fast and easy rendering with a very close to realistic or final result. I'm going to silence this phone because it is going to keep going off and we don't need that. So with Cycles, it is a physically based render engine. You can see here now that the shadow is actually a little bit smoother than before. In fact, I'm going to set this to a second slot. We're going to change the render engine back to Eevee. And we're going to render that again. So here's the first slot. And the second slot. So you can see that Eevee is not quite as accurate, but it gives you very close results, which is why we're going to use it today. The Cycles render engine is physically based. So in other words, it's based on actual ways light works in the real world. So it gives you a very realistic result. And you can also use it for stylized stuff, but it's a very powerful render engine. So depending on what you're doing, you could probably just get away with Eevee, which we're going to do today. But just understand that render engines will also change how they render things. It's also why Pixar has very specific Pixar-looking movies, because they have a render engine that handles light a very specific way. Anyway, moving on. So we've got that set up. I don't want to spend too much time trying to figure out where... So it's render engine. Do I have view render? It's probably stuck somewhere in settings, so I don't want to spend half a video looking for that. So we're going to keep that on Eevee. And we actually don't need too much. We don't really need a second light source because it looks like the light is going to be bouncing around. So we can actually keep this as is. All right, so before we continue on, however, we're going to go to File, Save As. We're going to make sure that we're saving this correctly. Let's go to Desktop, Blender Tutorials, Intro to Texturing, Blender Files. We'll put in today's date, which is for you guys, because I'm totally doing this on the same day that you are, 04.03.20, Nick S, texture. Actually, So I should explain why this naming convention is different from the one that I described prior. And let's see, texture intro. So because when I'm working inside Blender, I do like to use the camel casing just for the objects to make it really fast. But because I tend to have a number of different files, I like to have the spacing here and the capitalization, so it's a little bit easier to read in terms of like a long list. And this is also because that way I can clearly see what the separate sections are instead of having squished. Again, that's just the way I do it, but you're more than welcome to change it. So let's go to Save As. Okay, so how do we start texturing? Well, for starters, let's go ahead and click on the panther. And over on the right side, we've got this scene window here. And that's because it's set to render setting or scene settings. We're going to go over to this little tiny sphere, which is material properties. Now, back when I was texturing, you could still use the Blender render engine, which it was a decent engine. However, everything is moving toward using Cycles and Eevee because it's faster, more realistic, and there's a little less work involved in terms of setting up lights. So I'm going to click on new here, and yep, they're using the principled BSDF. So really quickly, this essentially stands for a very specific shader. Let me actually explain what BSDF stands for. I believe it's by scattering directional something or other. So BSDF, I'll get you the exact description here. BSDF stands for bidirectional scattering distribution function. Long story short, that is how in numbers and programming it describes what is happening with the light on the object or how the light is scattering off of the object to give it its appearance. Now, very recently, Blender moved everything to use one shader. So if we go up here to surface here, you can see that we have a bunch of different shaders. Some are specifically for hair, some are specifically for tune. We even got one for velvet. Well, we're going to look at all these in turn. But essentially, rather than having a bunch of different textures that describe a bunch of different things, Blender and a bunch of other companies started using principled BSDF to take all the variables together and control everything with very specific variables. So I'm not going to attack this today because I think I need a little bit more time to go through it. And for purposes of this demonstration, I just want to show you guys how to mess around with the node editor, which we're going to get to in a second, and just like how to think about the textures in general. So let's actually just set this to diffuse BSDF. And you can see that it's not quite as overwhelming now because we have a few different settings to mess around with. Again, these have all been transferred over into the principal BSDF, so you can change the material to anything you need to. But let's actually see. So you can see that there's a slightly different result over here. Basically, a diffuse BSDF is going to control the diffusion of the object or the material. This is commonly used for objects that are not very specular in nature. So, for example, let's add on a specular one. So you see now this is a lot more shiny. Whoop, was just a second ago. Here we go. We can crank that back up. I don't know why that's set back over to black. So if I go over to and start messing around with the roughness here, you can see that now we're getting some more specific highlights. In fact, it might be easier to see this on a UV sphere. Let's actually just generate some objects along with the panther because this is a very geometric shape, so it may not show up 100%. Let's actually pop in a sphere. We're going to move it over just for a split second, and I'll move the panther over here for just a smidge. And let's pop on a subdivision surface on the sphere. Here we go. And we're going to set this to smooth. I'm going to right click on this shade smooth. And we're going to pop on a material to this guy, change it from principal over to now. Where is it? Oh, this might actually be the old shader. Okay, here we go. So you can see as I play around with the roughness, this is going to change how this object is reflecting the light. So the less rough the material is, the more that highlight is going to show up. In fact, there we go. And we can also like change around the base color a little bit. Clear coat roughness. I don't know what this does. I'll have to read up on that. But you can see that how this is rendering. This is now more specular. It's more shiny. It's reflective. So this might be like plastics. We also have glossy, which is basically going to, if we adjust the roughness over here, I don't know why the color is coming out kind of fun. Whoa. Okay, that's kind of cool. But With a glossy BSDF, you're going to get a much, you know, more specific shiny coat here. And that's all these shaders do, is they change how the object is reflecting light. So we've got a glossy one here. Let's see, we already went over the diffuse, and you can see that now the light is scattering a lot more. There's no specific crazy highlight. Let's see what else we've got in here. We've got velvet, which is super weird to work with. It may not come up the great on here, because velvet has a really weird way that it reflects light. I can't remember the specifics of it, but velvet BSDF. I'm gonna just Google it real quick because it's super weird how the highlights happen. So we can see over here. So you can see that we don't really have enough detail on the object to see this effect, but because of the way that velvet reflects light, you can see that as this curves away from the object, that the light is bouncing in a very particular manner. And that's all these shaders do. They just change how the light acts on the object. So let me see. I'm changing Sigma over here, and I'm not seeing a heck of a lot. Maybe if I change this to different color or something, and then we've got... We're going to mess around with the... Oh, is the normal going to... Ooh. Interesting. So this is probably going to change around the... Looks like it's supposed to be changing the normal, which might have a part to do with this specific texture. We talked about normals previously and how they will control how the light bounces off of the object. Let's see what else we've got in here. Let's go for glass. Ooh, funky. Part of the reason we might be having a little bit of trouble with the glass texture is because glass is supposed to be transparent. You need objects around it to see how it works. So let's actually take the camera here, or actually we can just move this in front and see if we can get... Oh, I also have to take off the normal. We gotta clear that out. That's definitely affecting it. Stop it. Attribute? Vector? Whoa. That's kind of funky. Remove. There we go. And let's lower this back down. Oh, you know what it is? I think we're also supposed to combine it with a transparency node. That was actually something that I learned a while back. So basically, because the glass can act a little bit funky, they actually included a transparent BSDF, which would control... This is just coming out as black now for some reason. Let's just change the color. That might be affecting it. Nope. Let me see if I can show you what I'm talking about. I'm going to go up to the top here. And we're going to go over to the shader editor. And basically, these are nodes. What they're supposed to do is you can combine different nodes that do specific things. So everything that we were doing over here, let's change this back to, say, a glossy. So we were changing these specifically, one at a time, but you can change them and also send inputs into them as well. So for example, I could get a picture of something and pump it into the color, and then you would see like a pattern over here. So let's actually just show you how I would combine these together. So I'm actually going to delete the... Let's go ahead and delete the glossy for a second. I'm going to do a input... No, not input. Shader. Let's do a... transparent and a glass, and we're also going to do a there's a specific mix shader is what I want, and basically what I can do here is I can mix these together and put that toward the surface, and let's make sure that's 1.5, so I can change the factor here as well. Though we're not getting that great of a result. Ah, Blender. Maybe it's not transparent. Maybe it's glass and glossy I need. I'm trying to... Like I said, it's been a while. So that's fully glossy, and then that's supposed to be the glass. So we're not getting that great of a behavior around here. I know we're not even using the Panther right now. Let me just take these off for a second. And let's just go ahead and add in a transparent one. So why am I getting it all black? If it's transparent, should just be going straight through, no? Which is very odd. Is it because this needs a specific color? Let's actually just add something to the background plane. We'll just give it a diffuse texture for right now. That's very, oh, okay. So it is sort of transparent, or, oh no, that's because I had it selected. That's really weird. It's acting like a holdout where you tell it not to have any texture. I mean, this is kind of cool if you like want to do like a void sort of pattern, but it's clearly not what we're looking for. The mysteries of Blender ever confuse me. Just for fun, let me just see if I can replicate this with the principled BSDF. In fact, I might as well just come over here. So we've got the IOR. Let's just change the base color to something a little bit nicer. Subsurface is something we don't want to mess with right now. Okay, we can make it more metallic, fine, but we don't want to do that. Specularity. Whoop, no, don't do that. Specular tint. Okay, there we go. So we got the roughness and the specular works in combination with that. Okay, and that changes the color. I still don't know what clear coat does. Ooh. So transmission probably has something to do with the IOR here. Yeah, it seems to have an effect on it. So IOR is supposed to be the index of refraction, I think, not reflection. And basically, that's going to control the outer edges. If you ever look at glass where it's got the specific, you can see through it looking straight on, but as you get close to the edges, you kind of see more colors and things on the outside. That's due to the index of refraction. Light is passing through the glass, but then between the material, it's actually getting slightly bent and then sent out at a different angle. So that is what I'm attempting to figure out here with very little luck. All right, tell you what. I mean, does Eevee not handle this properly? That could be it as well. Just gonna switch this. Ah, okay. So. Yep. So, remember how I said each render engine is gonna handle things a little bit differently? Well, it turns out that Eevee can only handle a certain number of shaders. So this is why I was having some trouble. I was hoping to avoid showing how this works because you can see that this is now lagging a little bit, but we can now get back to our regularly scheduled program. I was wondering why that was messing up. It just did not look right at all. All right, so let's come back over selecting the sphere here. And let's just see what everything looks like. I'm betting this is why Velvet also... Yeah, that's why Velvet also messed up. There we go. I was wondering why, because I remember I never dove super deep into the materials as compared to like other folks online or, you know, artists, but I figured I should be able to at least do a simple material. You know, that threw me for a loop there. So we've got glossy, you know. This can mimic anything from, say, a very metallic-looking shader to something plasticky, depending on how you do it. We've got our glass, which, again, we've got our index of refraction, which is going to change how the light behaves. Now we got some sort of like funky crystal ball thing going on over here. You can combine that with the roughness, which is going to change, you know, how like if I turn this all the way off, this is basically acting like a mirror, more or less. So the index of refraction is really messing us up here. Oh, that's so much fun. That's all. That's very too much. It's very satisfying when you see that. So this is like this is a serious amount of warping going on here due to this. Now, one thing I'll say at this point, I should have mentioned it before. If you are running anything else, particularly if you're on a laptop or something, close everything else, save it, because your processor is going to be dedicated to running everything right now. So we've got the glass, we've got translucent, which is just what it sounds like. It's like partially translucent. This one I usually don't use by itself. It's usually combined with something else in the node editor here. So let's see what we haven't looked at. Diffuse we kind of looked at. This is just a little bit more of an accurate look here. Anisotropic. I'm trying to remember exactly what that does. And I'm just on the side here looking through Google because there's a lovely Blender manual that goes through everything. The anisotropic BSDF is used to add a glossy reflection with separate control over UV direction roughness. Yeah. So a classic example of this is if you look on the back of a CD and there's like a very specific, like the highlight is running an opposite direction to where like the actual object is. That's because the light again is being bounced a very particular way. There's also some color, I think it's chromatic aberration, if I remember right. But basically it's going to change how everything is mapped across it. So here's an example here. So you can see that we've got, instead of the shading like being done on a, I believe this is the rotation is on zero here. Let's say the light's like coming from up above. So instead of like being a round dot like it normally is, it is along the object, and this is being rounded around. And this is like sort of the stuff that you can see on like CDs, because it also the light is being reflected a very specific way. It is, you can get all kinds of, you know, crazy detail with this. See if there's anything else fun in here, and then I think you guys have gotten the detail. Oh, you can also set something to emit light, which is also fun. So basically this is now a light source. You can even crank it up like mah. We're gonna keep that at one though. Move this back over. And I think that's most of everything that you're gonna need here. And again, everything there has been kind of put together in the principled BSDF, which I was attempting to mess around with earlier. So I'm curious to see if this changes its behavior. Yes, it does. Because I was using the wrong render engine. All right, that makes sense. So with that all said, you know, now you have a better understanding of how to, like, what all the different shaders do, what the BSDF stands for. Let's see if we could just make a really interesting texture for the Panther. And while I wanted to work in Eevee, either I have something on my computer that doesn't let me take full advantage of it, so that might be something I have to dive into, but I think I'm going to use it on mine. If you're getting good results in your computer, great. But for now, we're going to click on our Panther over here. I'm going to go back to camera view. Let's slide this guy back over. Right now we had it on specular. Let's actually go ahead and let's delete this. I'm thinking it would be cool to make like a metallic sort of panther. You know what I mean? Like maybe it's like a cool sort of like black metallic geometric panther with maybe a little bit of texture detail. So let's go ahead and we're going to go and let's start with a glossy BSDF. And let's play around with this a little bit. Now, obviously, we're going to change the color, but I don't want to go pure black here. All right, so we'll change that to maybe a somewhat dark gray. But let's go ahead and lower the roughness a little bit. So now we're getting a lot of specific highlights, and it's very shiny. We could also combine this together with, say, let's add another shader. Oh, well, that's a add shader. Let's add a mix shader. You can actually just pop this in between here on the notes. Well, where did music go? Yes, give me the music. All right, so I was kind of experimenting around with this earlier, and essentially what you can do here is if you have one shader in one shader plug, another in here, you can change how the two are mixed together. So let's actually disconnect this for a second, and let's just show you a little bit more of an extreme example. Actually, we'll just do this with two diffuse shaders. So we'll put no. And I'm hitting Shift A to bring up this menu, but you can easily go up to add and you get the same menu up here. So let's go to, we'll put one diffuse here. We'll make this a red color and let's, stop it. I'm gonna Shift D and I'm gonna change this to say a blue color. We're gonna pop one in here and we're gonna pop one in here. Now you can see because we have this on 0.5, everything is mixing together 50%. As I move this more to the left, in this case, because I have this on the top shader here, this is now coming out as more of a purplish kind of color, bluish kind of color. And all the way over, it's now relying on that texture entirely. As we slide this over to the right, we're gonna see a little bit more of a red color. So you can do this with shaders as well. So we've got a glossy here. And because we don't have another texture, it's just coming out as pure black. So let's add in a, we've got glossy. I guess we could make it glass. Yeah, why not? Let's do it. Ooh. Well, that's interesting. Maybe we can increase the roughness a little bit. Change the IOR so it's not quite as crazy. And maybe we'll reduce this a little bit. Ooh, that's kind of cool. It's actually kind of like ice. It's an ice panther. Maybe we'll just drag this down a little bit more. So we get just a little bit of a hint of glass. We can even decrease the roughness here. So this pops up a little bit more. And we can even change the color here so it's not totally white. We could even, you know, do something that's a little bit crazier. Like maybe just add in just a hint of like purple. So we give it like that sort of like Black Panther sort of look. Wakanda. It's a great movie. I liked it. Let's see here. Okay. Now my cat decides to wake up. What do you want? We're doing textures over here. Oh, did you get mad there was another cat? Look, I have eyes only for you. You know this. He's giving me the scariest death glare right now. I think he's jealous. All right, cool. So we've got this sort of like texture over here. Now, we do have a little bit of roughness, but one thing we can do is we can give the material a little bit more bumpiness, which actually we may do last. Let's actually maybe add, we could do another mix shader here. And we can actually control the glass a little bit more. Let's do, well, we're kind of mixing that already. Let's actually keep that where it is. Maybe let's mix this so I get a little bit more behavior, because we're going to let the glass do what it needs to do. Let's do, so we have glossy, we have glass. Velvet would just be weird on this, though you could mess around with it. Maybe I will do, not a refraction one. There was another one I was using before. Can't remember. I'm blanking out on it right now. That's okay. Let me just see what this does. Because I'm curious. And we'll just pump that in there for a second. I mean, is there any difference between that and the glass? Doesn't look like it. No, do glass emission. Could have it emit light if you wanted to. Eh, I can't think of anything for right now, so let's actually just cut that out. We'll pop that there. Uh-oh. What'd I do here? Let's undo. Oh, it's because I didn't put this back over here. Got it. Okay, cool. So one thing that I have to do is make sure that we always have, because this is the material output. This is after everything gets calculated, and then it gets sent over here. Now, one thing we can do is we can give this a little bit of detail, and we can give it a little bit more texture. So right now, these are perfectly smooth here. And one thing I also want to point out, so you can see these like little fireflies here. Essentially, what Cycles will do is it's going to sample the image a number of times. That's what those little dots are. And sometimes, depending on the material that you have, the light is going to end up with these little fireflies. There are ways to reduce that. Generally, you can take more samples. You can also input some more nodes to reduce that. But I'm not too concerned about it. Let's go ahead and let's see what textures we've got here. We have... Let's see what a noise texture looks like. So what we can see here is now we are starting to see a little bit of detail on the surface. Can I actually see this? And do I have like an output node that I can do for this? Basically, I want something to help you guys visualize this. Let's actually apply it to the, let's apply it to the ground just so you can see, whoop. Just so you can see how this works. Texture. Let's do a checker texture. And let's actually pump this into the color. And we'll change this. I don't know why it's not already set to like a dark black here. All right, so basically what I've done here is Blender will come with default textures, and that will allow you to add details to the object. So this can be color, this can, and usually it comes in the form of color, but the other thing you can do is you can also pump this into displacement. And I'm actually going to, don't know if you can see that or not, so let's do, converter, vector, what am I, displacement. Here we go. May not be enough for you to see scale. All right, let me pop in a different texture here. All right. Oh, this doesn't have any color though. Okay, so that's gonna make it a little bit harder to visualize. Basically what I'm trying to do is, let's actually just grab an image from online to make this super easy to understand. So let's get a sand texture. I'm just gonna look up an image of sand. Yeah, this one will do. Okay. Now, because I'm doing this super quick, I'm not going to go ahead and put it in my folder because I'm not going to use it toward the actual project. But let's go ahead and do texture, image texture. I'm going to open up. Let's see. Do I have a preview here? Going on a dream. Download one. Okay, great. All right, so there's my texture for the sand. That's what I downloaded. And what we can do for this, first off, I'm going to input. Now we'll leave it as is. But I am going to take. Displacement mapping. Not the one. Like I said, it's been a while since I've worked with this. It's normal map, vector, converter, shader, output, input. Oh, I think it's under input. Texture coordinate is what I need. I mean, technically it's fine on its own, but. And then do I have. I need something to scale it. So let's do 20. Yeah, there we go. I just want something to repeat it. So you can see that by controlling the various different nodes, that you can combine them together in interesting ways. I'm just trying to repeat this texture so it's a little bit more evident on how this works. I guess we don't have to worry about Z in this case. Let's just do this by, say, oh, that's kind of cool. I mean, it's a little bit of an obvious scene, but you get the idea. All right, so I've used a texture coordinate node, which is going to change how this is mapped onto the object. The mapping here allows me to shift the image around, change its scale, that kind of stuff. Make sure my audio is okay here. Then we have the actual image texture that's being projected, and I'm putting that into the color so that way we can see it on here. And what I want to do here is I want to have this image drive the displacement of this object. And what I mean by that is you can take an image and use the black and white information to tell it to move things up and down or make it appear to do so just based on the color information. So what I'm going to do here, and if I remember how to do it correctly, is we're going to pump something into the displacement over here. And let's do, it's probably a converter. RGB to black and white. Just for fun, I want to see what happens over here. Oh, there we go. I was hoping that would come in a little bit smoother. But basically, what I've got going on over here is Blender is taking the black and white information, and then it is scaling this up and down. Well, not really scaling it. That's wrong to say. You may remember that in a previous tutorial, I talked about normals. And what this is doing is it is... Let me back up. So on this plane, there are... I don't know why this isn't showing up now. Great. Oh, showing up over here. Oh, that's because it's render view. So on this, say, cat over here, each one of these faces has a normal pointing in a very specific direction, depending on which one this is, which one I'm looking at. The normal will dictate where or how it gets getting lit. So normals that are pointed toward this light source are receiving light. Ones that are pointing away from it are not, and they are in shadow. You can use an image texture to adjust the normals or the displacement. Now, in this case, I think the displacement is actually changing the geometry a little bit. I think that's a physical displacement. And then the normal is supposed to change the normals on the figure to make it appear as if there's been a displacement. So there's an actual like changing of like light shifting versus an actual displacement. And I'm trying to remember which one it is because it's been a while. So we're going to go back to the Blender manual. I'm going to double check. Material output. I'll actually show you what I'm doing on screen here. Because there are so many settings in Blender that it's nigh impossible to remember everything. Displacement node, emission. Let's actually go over to, let's see, where would physics, rendering, I suppose. Shader nodes, input. This would be output, material node. Used to create bump mapping or actual subdivided displacement. Oh, so it's either? That's weird. Huh. I guess this controls the normal for the material, not the actual output. So by taking this, basically, I can start to create a more detailed map. I think this is a physical displacement, though. I don't think, or it could be. I may have to crank this up a little bit more. Do I have a value here? Color ramp, map range, math. Could I use a math? Try just to multiply, see what happens. Okay, yeah, so I think we're starting to see that a little bit. I'm just going to crank this up to extreme here. It could also be that I have to make the image a little bit darker, because there may not be enough contrast for me to get the amount of detail that I'm looking for. But let's review what I've done so far, because it is coming up on an hour. We've hit a couple bumps, but, you know, figuring out steady bit by steady bit. So, to create a shader or a material on an object, you go ahead into the shader properties or material properties. You select the type of shader you want. And then from there, you can use the shader editor to mix nodes together. In the case of the Panther, we combined, we're going to get rid of this for now, we combined a glass and a glossy texture to create this sort of glass-like Panther. And we changed a few of the settings to change the behavior of both of them respectively to get this unique material. From here, what I'm going to do in just a second is I want to use either a texture that's generated by Blender or an image texture to change the small surface qualities of this model, because nothing is super crazy smooth in real life. And I've used a combination of a texture coordinate, which changes how this is mapped on here. The mapping will actually change like the size, the scaling, where the location is. This is the actual image texture. So this is going to, basically these are nodes that are going to control how this is mapped on. The color is then passed on to the actual shader. We are taking the color information, converting it into black and white, multiplying a little bit, and then pumping it into the actual displacement of the ground, which we're going to crank back down now. In fact, do we even need this? I was just doing that for an example. We could probably actually decrease it slightly. So let's do a divide, 1.5. Yeah, so we start to see like a little bit more of that detail. Obviously, there's a really ugly seam here that we would have to get rid of, but that's okay. This is just for an example. Now let's go back over to our Panther. In fact, if we're smart about this, we will go back to the ground here. And we will use the mapping here to just slide that seam out of the way so we just don't see it. It's still there. All right, so we're gonna slide. Can we just hide it out of camera view for right now? All right, it's a little bit over there. So maybe if we change the scale a little bit, and maybe I can slide it over. Ah, dang it. All right, let's go back to 1x1. And we won't see that. We shouldn't see that tiling anymore. But now it's too large. All right, let's go back to... All right, I was trying to hide it. No dice. Let's go back to... Oh, this should be higher. 2, 3. All right, it's not perfect, but again, there's not a lot of contrast in this image, so that may not be the best picture to use, but you get the idea. If I were to actually go through and do some terrain, oh, my back. Basically what I would actually do, instead of depending on the material to create like these rolling sand waves, I would actually do the majority of the modeling first and then use a texture to add on the little details of the sand to give that a little bit more variety. But we're focusing on the panther. So back to the panther here. Let's add on a, could just do a noise, but let's see. Let's try point density noise, Musgrave. Let's try a Musgrave texture. We're gonna pump that into the displacement. And we're definitely gonna lower the scale down. Or should we increase it? Okay, increasing it, sounds good. So let's try 30. All right, yeah, now you can see we're getting like these little tiny bumps and knickknacks and whatnot. Let's change the detail down to say 1. Dimension, let's see what that does. Not a heck of a lot. Might be because we have this pattern repeating a lot, because it kind of does this sort of, not quite waves per se, but it does change the behavior. I think it's a little bit easier to see if this is larger. However, I don't want this to be as intense. I want it to be subtle. So we're gonna go back to that math node here, and we're going to divide. This needs to be higher though for that to work. Not quite seeing the... Okay, so we do have to crank that up a little bit. Let's try 25. I only want it very, very, very small. So you kind of see it in the highlights a little bit. We probably will need to scale this down a little bit more though. Okay, that's interesting. Basically what I did here was we're dividing the factor that's getting output so it's not as high on the displacement. What does clamp do? Clamp does what? Oh, okay, so that just changes the output to a between a range here. So 0 to, I think it says 0.1, or is that 0 to 1? A little hard to see. All right, let me try another texture just to see if we get something that's a little bit better. Let's just see what noise does. And let's set this back to a 1. Okay, so it's not quite as lumpy. So maybe instead of making this very small, we can just add in some like kind of like interesting streaks here. Let's try. All right, I think that's kind of cool because we have these kind of like interesting streaks going through it now. But now we've got a purple panther with some interesting streaks going through it. It's kind of like changing up how the light is acting. It's like it's not perfectly made glass. And we've got a little bit of a mixture of, so I guess we can delete this. And we've got this glass and glossy mix shader over here. So this was definitely interesting because I have not messed around with materials in quite a while, but you get the idea. The main thing here is to experiment and definitely to use what happened to my blender window here. Definitely check out the blender manual because this is going to go over just about everything that's in here. It's not perfect, but Blender does a really good job of keeping it updated as much as they can, and it goes through all the details. I had to reference it a few times while we were going through this, and I also had to experiment. So it's a very interesting process learning how to do this stuff, and I have to actually get back into the groove of things quite a bit. But hopefully this gives you a better idea of how to create materials in Blender. You do need some lights. You've got the general different types of shaders that control how light is bounced off of an object. And by combining them together using the node editor, mixing in with textures, you can change what objects look like. And that's going to wrap it up for today. Let's just make sure we save this. And I'm just going to use the same name because it's the same day. So maybe we'll come back and revisit this at a certain point. And with any new skills we've learned, we will apply it and make some pretty cool stuff. So this is Nick. Thank you for joining me, and I'll see you in the next video. Definitely don't forget to subscribe, like our videos, and a little bit later today at 2 p.m., I am going to be doing some dungeon creation. This is going to be a cool game design exercise where I come up with an idea for a dungeon and start moving it into Unity in order to make like an actual playable game. That's not going to be an easy process, but I really want to try it out because I'm very influenced by Jedi Fallen Order. I have an interesting idea that I think might be fun to try. But we also have a bunch of different, you know, things up on the web. So check those out as well. We've got tech tips at 12, see our full schedule. And above all else, if you've liked anything that I've done here, or you've liked something else on our other videos and you want to learn it, reach out to us so that way we can teach it to you. You know, we're a bunch of enthusiastic people who love to learn stuff, and any skills that we can pass over to students, we're happy to do. All right, I said my spiel, I'm done. Have a good day, guys. I'll see you later.